The first most important step is we have to realize that we were duped into coming into this world in the first place by the promise of an alliance with the ego. What is taking place in this world is there's this belief that we can make an alliance with the ego. Together we can find the answer. What happens when we make an alliance with the ego is that the ego starts saying, well, this threatens our alliance. Don't think that. That's going to threaten our alliance. Don't think this. This threatens our alliance. And so it uses the threat of the alliance breaking up to basically get you to turn away from truth entirely. And so most definitely there was a mirage here that seemed to be a grand alliance was possible. And to build up half-truths, and that suckered us into this world. The best advice is don't come into this world in the first place unless you are perfectly awake. This world really is like a coma hospital, severe coma for people here, and they seek alliances with the ego. That they see salvation as forming an alliance with the ego. And so when you try to speak truth, the ego says, hey, why are you listening to that one? That's threatening our alliance. I mean, we have great work that we need to do. We need to work together. And we have this alliance. Come on, let's don't blow our beautiful marriage, you know, our beautiful alliance by listening to someone there who's speaking so directly and clearly. That's going to ruin our alliance. And you won't be able to help the world and all this kind of stuff. Well, the best way to help the world is don't come here in the first place. Then there is no world, right? The idea that somehow we have to help a world is ridiculous. Totally ridiculous. That's the ego saying that. The ego and egoic alliances is what rules this world, rules this place. It's an insane asylum. It's a coma hospital, really. This storm here is all hat and no cattle, really. We're supposed to get all this rain here. We got like, 0.2 of an inch or something. It's ridiculous. Kind of like the world. We thought, oh, we're going to make all this progress, this great progress here, so let's come into the world and help out. And it turns out that all of this stuff, you know, all this technology was coming, I'm supposed to make, you know, communication all the world possible. I'm so incredibly disappointed by the whole technological situation. It's so incredibly underwhelming. What a vast disappointment. Yeah, just a severe disillusionment. I can't believe how ineffective it's been, really. Pathetic is a way to put it. Utterly pathetic. And there's all these people saying, oh, well, yeah, we're building this new world. We're, you know. Building a new world. What kind of talk is that? That's egoic alliance talk. What we need to do is wake up to our vast richness. We need to open our eyes. We have our eyes shut to reality. And in our shut-eyeness, we are trying to build a better world. What utter folly is that? It's just total folly. our true richness is the totally smoothed out vastness, where it's completely impossible for anything not to be totally sacred and totally blessed. In fact, everything is already that way. Everything is totally blessed, totally smoothed out sacredness and vastness. We only closed our eyes to our riches. The riches are still there. It's all exactly the same as it's always been. And we get a little glimpse of it, and then we go back to sleep into a coma and say, okay, now we know how, we get some idea of how we need to make this world. And open the eyes and keep them open. And what needs to be done? What needs to be done in the world? Then decide what needs to be done, if anything. What needs to be done to a dream? Do we need to work on a dream and fashion it in certain ways? Or do we need to wake up from it? So the fact is, we've had this alliance with the ego, which is really just a projection. We have an alliance with a projection. The ego is really a projection of our own attempt to dispossess ourselves of everything, of our riches. We're trying to dispossess ourselves so that we can claim that we're greater than God, that God didn't give us anything. How could God give us anything? We say we're greater than God. God didn't give us anything. We gave God. We're going to give God everything. So we have to try and dispossess ourselves of everything that God's given us, which is everything, which is the total smoothed out vastness. And so we close our eyes to that, completely close our eyes to it. And we focus on our dreaming, which we think that we're giving God that. We think we're giving God the world. You see, no, we need to work on this world because this is what we're giving God. That's really what we're doing. So of course we say we need to build a better world. We really need to build a better world. Why? for who? For what? For us? Why? We have the total smoothed out vastness. So we don't need the world. We don't need the world. What do we need the world for? It's just a little ornament, decoration. So that's a decoration. Little tiny decoration, a little bubble. What's that to us? It's just one with the smoothed out vastness. We have everything. Because God has given us everything. So what we're really doing when we say we need to make a better world is we're saying we're working on giving God something. Because we believe we're prime creator. And so we say, this world is what we're giving to God. And so we don't open our eyes to what our true riches are. We don't. And so we're in this alliance with the ego, because the ego says, hey, I'll work with you to help you make this world a better place so you can give this to God and show God, you know, that you're the creator. And you say, oh yeah, great. I mean, we can make this world better and I can feel more confident about my creative ability to be prime creator. And the ego says, sure, I'll help you with that. We got all this technology, we'll connect everybody with, you know, Twitter, everybody will be tweeting each other, and Facebook, you'll be posting, hey, I love you on Facebook. And then God will look at this and say, oh my gosh, how blessed I am that I'm being given this world. Without this world, I would have nothing. Oh my gosh, this world has made me fulfilled. Now I realize, God says, oh, now I realize my place is actually, the Son is greater than the Father, and the Son is giving to the Father. Oh, the direction of creation has now been reversed. Oh, how fortunate I am, how wonderful. That's what, you know, we're about here in this world. That's what the ego and all this alliance is. We are still very deluded here. Even the spiritual teachers on this planet I've seen are deluded. Many of them. The real ones, you know, because when you say, hey, we need to make a better world, they just say, this world is completely perfect exactly as it is. You don't need to do anything. You need to just open your eyes to your true inheritance. There have been some real teachers here, but what I see now is those who are making alliances with the ego and saying, together, we can make a better world. Sorry, but that's the facts. I didn't come here to lie and deceive and make an alliance with the ego. That's not the way for anyone. That's the way of delay. God is not waiting for us to give God something. God is waiting for us to open our eyes and accept what God has given us, which is the smoothed out vastness of everywhereness, that everything is present as it is present in this smoothed out vastness. There's nothing that needs to be done to make that so. It's already the case. And this is our domain. This is our reality. This is our world. Our world is the smoothed out vastness of everywhereness. That is our world. That's our world. This place is not our world. This place is one with our world. There's a little bubble, a little speck, a little decoration. Our world is the totality, is the smoothed out vastness. That is not changed by anything that appears in it. Man, this world's all hat and no cattle, isn't it? It's all hat and no cattle. But the problem is we want to see progress. And so this alliance with the ego gives us this illusion of progress, and we can't seem to drop it. We say, no, we're making too much progress. Look, everybody's connected. What about the completely smoothed out vastness that already is the case? Is that not perfect connectedness? I mean, beyond that, it's even beyond the idea of connectedness. And they say, yeah, well, we're kind of copy that. And so we can give God the new creation and say, God, here's our new creation. Here's the world. Here's an example. We want this world to be a shining example of our new creation, of what we can do. Yeah, connect everybody with smartphones. How's that going for everybody? There's this vast collective delusion in this world, a collective delusion, very powerful collective delusion among these tech people. And they're marketing it ferociously marketing that you're supposed to be tweeting to the world in social media. It's like, wow, they're like, again, ferocious. The entertainment world is ferocious about this. The celebrity world's ferocious. This is what is being foisted upon us all. This is the alliance between the ego and supposedly the spirit. The alliance that has supposedly been forged. And we think now there's this grand alliance, and this is our opportunity. See, this is our opportunity to create a model world that we can say, God, here's our creation. Aren't you fortunate? You can now live in our creation. This is the truth. This is what's going on here. Very disappointing. Very disappointing. But in recognizing it, we can work, we can get through it. You know, the real teachers, they didn't lift a finger to build a better world, did they? Now, Ramana, what's he doing? Is he building a better world? No, he's just sitting there in the stunning stillness. The smoothed out vastness, really. Just abiding in the smoothed out vastness and saying, this is your real home. This is the real self. This is already the case. This is the creation of the prime creator, God the Father. prime creator. And here we are saying, no, 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 we have an alliance. There's God the Father, God the Mother, and there's this alliance, you know. And what we're doing is we're bringing about something superior to, quote unquote, God the Father, God the prime creator. That we're now going to give that prime creator a new creation, which is even better than their creation. They'll be, and God the Father will be so happy and say, oh my gosh, I never thought of that. That's amazing. God the Son, you've outshone me. You've outshined me. You've done something superior to my creation. Amazing. And the ego is saying, oh yeah, we need to, you know, blend spirit and matter, the formless unform. We need to come up with this amalgamation, this dialectic of half-truths being superior to both truth and lies. Lies are nothing. So how can you come up with something from lies and truth? So this is what we're doing. It's very disheartening here, of course, in this world, to recognize, like, wow, this is what's going on. It's frustrating. Because there is no opportunity here except to open your eyes to your true inheritance. Other than that, there is no opportunity taking place here. There never is. There's never any opportunity in alliance with the ego. None. And yet we spend our time chasing after this. And there's all sorts of leaders of this opportunity, non-existent opportunity, which constantly making it seem interesting. And they talk a good talk, but they never really emphasize that you cannot have an alliance with the ego. Because they feel in order to get their message out, they need an alliance with the ego is the problem. And see, we think, oh, with all this technology, etc., we should be able to get the message out. Now, what's happening in the world is by buying into all this technology, what's happened is the ego is getting its message out. The ego has just used us. The ego is getting its message out to everyone, which is half-truths are superior to truth. So we're being used. I mean, the teachers in this world, what I see, they're being used by the ego. Just being used to get people to buy in, more and more people to buy into the technology. So that the ego can get its message across to more and more people here. That's really what's taking place. So the heart of this is repentance. Realize, wow, I've been duped. I've been duped. I was duped. You know, was deceived by the overall rush of it. You know, by so many saying, well, wow, it's finally, but there's a way now. And it's just like the enthusiasm and everything, the collective enthusiasm. You know, eventually swayed us to come here, and thinking there was an opportunity here. There's no opportunity here. It's the same. The opportunity here is the same opportunity everywhere. It's exactly the same. Opportunity is always maximal. Okay, here's a nice practice. Opportunity is always maximal. The location of this opportunity doesn't matter. Opportunity is always maximal. Which is to open our eyes to our true our true nature. Our true inheritance, our true riches, unlimited, unaccountable for, unlimited, right here, right now, always, and forever. There's no end to this show without doing anything at all. As it is, this very moment, our opportunity is maximal, always. It's always been that way, always will be. Without doing anything. This idea of saving the world, you know, making, what are they saying? Really? They're really saying we need to save our plan to give God something better than reality. That's what they're really saying. The world doesn't need to be saved. Everything is already perfectly in the arms of reality. What needs to be saved from what? So opportunity is always maximal. Right here, right now. Location doesn't matter. Location doesn't matter in the slightest bit. Opportunity already is totally maximal and always will be. There's nothing that can change that in the slightest bit. So what do we have to change in the world? Opportunity is already totally maximal. What has to happen? No. Nothing has to happen or not happen. It makes no difference. Opportunity is always maximal, completely maximal in every moment. Every moment, every moment, every moment, this moment, every moment, as it is, meaning this very moment, as it is means this very instant before anything can possibly be thought of one way or the other, added or subtracted from this instant whatsoever, as it is, this moment as it is optimal. This location as it is optimal. This moment as it is optimal. Totally optimal. Without a second. Totally optimal without a second. Settled down and gone to sleep. Back into its coma. Dreaming of making a better world so we can impress God and say, God, look at our creation. Aren't we? You see, I told you we'd come up with something better than reality, huh? but then we say, well, we're not quite there yet. We need to go back into our coma and work on it a little longer. And we need to hear some few more tweets from some celebrities, a few more songs from a few more bands, and we need to know what somebody's thinking. We need to like something. Oh, yeah, I like this. I mean, really, this is such an absurdity, what's happening. I live in the heart of Silicon Valley, have my whole life. I can tell you there's nothing happening here whatsoever. Nothing's happening. Nothing ever happened here, actually. And every moment is optimal. Every moment is totally optimal. Every moment as it is totally optimal. Meaning, even before the moment, even transcending, or even saying the moment doesn't... I mean, the moment as it is, before it's even a moment, is optimal. So before, prior to this moment being a moment, even prior to that, as it is, prior to this moment, as it is totally optimal. Because the smoothed out, vastness is already there. It's there. It's there. It's there. It's there. It's here. It's here. It's here. It's everywhereness. And everything is abiding in that everywhereness. Completely abiding it. Never can it separate, be separate from it. Never. Everything is already totally sacred. It's completely impossible that anything not be totally sacred as it is. Exactly as it is, totally impossible. And nothing has to be done to make this so at all. So as they say, the real teachers say, give up your efforts. You don't need to make any efforts. Just stop, call off your searching, your seeking, your efforts. You don't need to do anything. No one has to do anything this very moment. Because this very moment is totally optimal. this location, this moment is totally optimal. I tell you what's happening with all the smartphones and the tweets and Facebook and social media. It's a massive distraction. It is a massive, massive distraction. From those who don't want to listen to those who speak the truth. They don't want to listen. So they say, no, I'm too busy communicating with people. This is where it's at. You know, just let's connect everybody. This is the answer. No, it's not. The answer is to pay attention to those who speak the truth. Abide in that. Did I watch the Open Olympic Games? No, in fact, I was not even aware that it was even happening until someone told me, oh, it's on, you gotta watch it. No, I'm not even the slightest bit interested. Not in the slightest bit. Oh, but the world is getting together. All this technology and the fireworks and stuff. What's going on? You're not, you know, what's going on? Now, this very moment is totally optimal. Right here. The location of this moment doesn't matter. This moment is totally optimal. This moment as it is totally optimal. So, you really have a world populated by people who are frantically engaged in trying to distract themselves away from listening to truth. So in such a situation, you don't, you know, obviously, from a pragmatic standpoint, you have to also be pragmatic. There is not really much teaching possibility here. There's nobody really listening. Very few want to listen at all. They're into distraction and pushing. They'll listen to you only to make an alliance. They say, okay, now how can I bring you into alliance with the ego? You know, because that's what's going to work, they say, because we need to make the world show God that we're better than God. And you get all these, that's what I'm picking up from this world, is the world is full of this mood of doing that. So there's really very limited teaching possibilities here. So it's better to go to some place where there's, you know, teaching possibilities, or where people are disillusioned enough to listen at some point. Because our world is the vastness. That is our world. Is the totality. That is our world. This planet is like a little backwater and a little swamp, you know, as far as receptivity. It's really like a coma hospital, and a lot of times in a coma hospital, you kind of have to give it time for the, you know, slow. It can be slow to wake up from the healing, very slow sometimes. And again, the overwhelming mood of this planet is to continue. The way that the teaching is received here in this world is, oh, okay, you have some truth? Great. Let's blend it with lies, and we'll have this great alliance between truth and lies, and then we'll be able to show God that we have something better. That's how it's taken. That's how it's taken. Even Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma said, you know, most people who come to me don't come to me for truth. What she's really saying is they come to make an alliance. And when they couldn't make an alliance, they ignored her. You know, the great politicians would come to her, and when they found out, you name them, you name it, the top ruling people of India came to her, and when they found out they couldn't make an alliance with her, they forget about it. Let's, you know, nothing here, let's move on, nothing here. That's literally what happened. You're not going to find a better example or teacher than Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. You're not going to find a better one. You know, same with Ramana Maharshi. You're not going to find a better one. You know, these are optimal teachers. These are teachers that realize the total optimalness of every moment as it is. Every moment as it is totally optimal. These are teachers who have realized this and accepted it entirely. You're not going to get better than that. You can't. You can't get better than that. That's the top gold standard. You know, there's no limit to the number of top teachers that can come into any place, actually, because eventually we will all realize the total optimalness of every moment, of this moment as it is. But we've had those teachers, and the world didn't listen to them, really. The world tried to form an alliance with them. Now, I came into this world trying to bring truth, and, you know, the world insisted on alliance with me, and I succumbed to that. So that's why I've not been able to be like Ramana Maharshi, because the push of this alliance was so intense at this time. I was not able to reject that as the nonsense that it was. But I am waking up from that coma. So that's why I have been in touch with those who are awake. You're just like doctors. When you're waking up, you hear the doctors talking, and you say, "Oh, hi, doctor." And they say, "Hi, how are you?" They say, "Oh, hi." And so you realize the doctors are there. And these those who have realized that this moment as it is totally optimal, those are like the doctors awakening us from the coma. And so when you start awakening from it, you're in touch with them. You realize, oh, yeah, there is this team, this coma team that is helping awaken. So it's no big deal. I'm just aware, yeah, there are these doctors. Longchenpa got in touch with me. Jesus got in touch with me and saying, I'm working to, help, I'm part of this coma team. It's not just one doctor. There's many doctors, actually. Many doctors who have realized the optimal and the total optimalness of this moment as it is. There's only optimalness as it is. There's only total optimalness as it is. There's only smoothed out vastness as it is. That's all. That's all there is. That there isn't anything, any other situation at all. And this is something that I can realize. It's something that you can realize. We will all realize this eventually. So we'll all realize. How can we not realize it? It's all that there is. This is all there is. It's total optimalness. There isn't anything other situation. So of course, no choice but to wake up. We'll all wake up out of our coma. So to say that, this teacher is greater, that is greater, and that they're the only one, or this is the only one, is part of our coma. It's part of our coma. It's part of our coma. Because we think it's easier to seduce one teacher into our plan of showing God, giving God some greater reality, than it is to seduce many teachers. This is really why we are so insistent that there's only one teacher that's enlightened, no other teacher, because we think, if we put our collective efforts, we can seduce that teacher and get them on our side and say, hey, help us make this world a show place for God so we can show God that we're greater than God. But if there's lots of enlightened teachers, we say, oh my gosh, how can we ever seduce all of those teachers? Really, I'm just telling you the straight truth. This is what's going on. So for me, I always was aware of so many enlightened teachers and accepted all of them equally. All of them equally, just of course. How could it be otherwise? Is there something greater than total optimalness? No. Is there something other than it? No. So of course they're equal in the same boat. There isn't any other realization. So the idea of greater or lesser is just, there's different styles. Anyway, this is something the world just has an extreme problem with. So let me just go back to the issue of, we believe it's easier to seduce one teacher than many, which is why we have such severe problems here. Is why do you have the sectarianism? Okay, let's be honest. Is we say because our teacher, whoever it is, a founder of our religion, that's the greatest one. Now, what are we saying by that? We're saying it's really the only one. And what are we saying by that? We're saying it's easier to seduce just one teacher than it is many. So we think that if we really work on this teacher, we'll be able to get them on our side, and they'll help tell us how the secret of how we can make this world a model home, showcase home, so then we can sell God on the belief that we're greater than God, that we have managed to combine truth and lies into a half-truth, and that this is the new creation, and that we're the real prime creators, and God is now, and now we're giving creation to God. That is what's actually taking place. That's why all the sectarian violence, you see all the violence in the world, sectarianism, that's the basis of it. That's the basis of it. Let's be honest, that religions throughout history have warred against one another severely, and that there's been sectarian splits within religions that have warred against each other severely. It's all based on this. It's all based on this, which is ludicrous. Okay, ludicrous. Again, I'm totally ecumenical, universal. I accept from anywhere and everywhere that there are teachers from everywhere and everywhere. Everywhere. those who have simply realized total optimum, each moment as it is totally optimal. The smoothed out vastness is here now. Location that does not make any difference whatsoever. This is the universal realization. So of course, my hope is there's billions and trillions of perfectly realized teachers. All of them equally adept, actually. From a pragmatic standpoint, you can talk about differences, but we need to also connect to the actual situation. So you want to end violence on this world, you want to end all this stuff, then you have to realize the optimalness as of each moment as it is. And then there's a flip side of so many teachers that are in alliance with the ego. And the ego promotes this ecumenicalness to say, oh yeah, sure, there's lots of teachers, but it's only promoting its teachers that are in alliance with it. And saying, okay, let's make a one world religion, let's smooth all this out by following the lead of teachers that are in alliance with the ego. That is a disaster, but that doesn't work. How about recognizing the real teachers who are not in alliance with the ego from all different traditions, which there are? From every tradition has brought forth teachers that have accepted the moment as is, the total optimalness of this moment as it is. Why not listen to them? But no, the ego's busy generating all these hybrid half-truth teachers that are in alliance with the ego and saying, look how ecumenical the ego is. It's leading the way in ecumenicalness and universality. Not only for its plan to be the new prime creator, not in God's plan. And what is God's plan? It's the Holy Spirit, which gives us a perception of this smoothed out vastness instead of actually knowing it, which is too abrupt a step for us. So I think one of the great realizations of this video, I always try to have a number of really great realizations to pass on, and so far I've succeeded at that, we think it's easier to seduce one teacher than many. And so that's why you get idolatry, that's why you get worshiping of the teacher. Because the people really are saying, okay, we'll make you the only teacher there is. You're awakened, that's great, let's make you the only teacher there is. We're willing to worship you, we're willing to do anything you want. What they're really saying is, we really need to seduce you into helping us make this world a model to show God that we're better than, greater than God. So we're willing to do anything, willing to work with you, willing to make an alliance with you. We'll say you're the all greatest teacher, the only teacher there ever is, but if you'll have us agree to an alliance with us. That's really what they're saying. That's what they're doing. That's exactly what's going on. So all you need to do is just recognize this. And of course, the whole key to the whole thing is a continuity problem. And say, it starts with, say, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a survival problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem that I have. So I'm in a mood of repentance. I tried to deceive God. There's no question. I've been trying to impress God that I'm greater than God, and trying to come up with this new creation of half-truths. And I'm so used to doing this, I have a continuity problem. When you admit you have a continuity problem, you can forgive yourself for everything that you tried to do. Forgive yourself. I don't have any guilt over what I tried to do. I have forgiven myself for it, because I put all that forgiveness into the continuity problem. Say, God, I know you forgive me, but I have a continuity problem. You know, I have a problem in letting go of what I've done, because I'm used to it. So and then God says, no problem. I you're absolutely right. And so Holy Spirit, you don't have to jump into knowing it, directly knowing it. You don't have to do that. There's a vision of it. So when the people who are awakened here say they're awakened, they're having a vision of the smoothed out vastness. They're not knowing it. The only ones that we've ever had in this world who know it are the avatars, etc. The perfect, the awakened ones, the great teachers. They both know it and also are having a vision of it to help us here in this world. It's very tricky. But there's some are sent to this world that actually both know it and have a vision of it, so they can show us, yeah, it's possible to have a vision of it. But that knowing it is beyond that. But don't worry, your goal is this vision of the smooth out vastness. So, you know, we're really not having God realization, we're having the intermediate step. When those who say they're enlightened, they're having the intermediate step. It's that we're perceiving the smoothed out vastness. We have this feeling of the smoothed out vastness. But that's still a kind of perception, actually, which is fine, because it reminds us of reality. That's all we need. So forgiveness means to accept we have a continuity problem. That's how forgiveness works. If you don't accept that, it means you're not forgiving yourself, and you're continuing then to try and impress God that you're greater than God. We're not repentant. There's very few people, the mood of repentance is very rare in this world. I'm not coming across the mood of repentance very often here. Because when you realize, you repent, you realize, you say, oh my gosh, I got a continuity problem. That's exactly what happens. You say, oh no. You know, I mean, I got to drop all this. Oh my gosh, I got a continuity problem. Yes. So that is why I'm saying to work at it from the angle of a continuity problem is the most effective approach that I've seen. What I've been to come up with is the most effective approach. Or at least I would say it's an extremely effective approach. I leave the door open to say, well, it is conceivable that there's some other approach that's extremely effective too. But that in no way lessens the extreme effectiveness of this approach, in no way. It's not an either or at all. It's not an either or. This is an extremely effective approach to say, focus on the continuity problem, and the Holy Spirit solves the continuity, has the solution to the continuity problem. Make that primary. Say, I don't have a survival problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a forgiveness problem, I have a continuity problem. Once, the more we can accept this continuity issue and get comfortable with it, the easier it is then to forgive ourselves and to recognize what we've been trying to do. What I see in the world is nobody recognizes what's going on, what they've been trying to do. It's not there because they're too scared to. Because then they realize they have this gigantic continuity problem and they say, wow, oh, this is impossible, whoa, freak out. Again, so if you go at it from the angle of I have a continuity problem and work on that, then it's easy to see what's going on. For instance, I just saw that the idea of making one savior is to make it easier to seduce. I think I can seduce this one savior more than many saviors. So I'll concentrate and worship this savior. This is the only one. And anyone else, I'll attack anybody else who says anything differently. Because again, attack, you know, your fear, desperate fear. That clarity can only arise when you don't have fear of the continuity issue, when you've got confidence that the Holy Spirit has solved the continuity issue. How else can that possibly arise? See, there's no fear in my saying that whatsoever, none. Whereas most people cannot bring themselves to think in that way. They have to say, no, I need to defeat somebody. Somebody's got to be defeated here. Somebody has to be seduced, you know, out of fear of the continuity issue. Otherwise, they'd recognize this whole thing is completely bogus, what we're doing. This whole dream is totally bogus. It's no value, zero value. It goes absolutely nowhere. It's a zero. And they say, oh, I got to drop it then. What do I do? Oh, we plunge back into knowing the vastness. Oh my gosh, it's too much. I'm scared. I can't do it. So the whole thing is to recognize you have a continuity problem. Say, I have a continuity problem, and I love my continuity problem, and I'm not letting go of my continuity problem for anyone, any reason whatsoever. I am holding that close to me. I have a continuity problem, but that's the only problem I have. fall in love with your continuity problem, and you'll fall out of love with all other problems. Most definitely. And then your clarity will be astonishing to the world. Astonishing. I mean, the stuff I say, uh-oh, can I say this? I better not say it, because it's astonishing. It doesn't astonish me, but I realize it is astonishing to say this to those who are fearful. But they say, how can you say such things? You say, how come you're not afraid of the consequences and stuff of saying this? Totally based on, I've accepted I have a conduit problem. Entirely based on that and nothing else. Nothing. It's not based on some savior. It's not based on anything like that. It's only based on, I trust the Holy Spirit. I know I have a conduit problem. I've accepted that I have a conduit problem. And that's the only problem I have. And I trust the Holy Spirit. That's it. That's why. It's the only reason. And the only reason other people are not saying this is because they don't have enough trust, and they don't have not accepted that they have a continuity problem. They're still thinking they can make an alliance. They say, well, yeah, let me have alliance with the ego. Okay, I'll make an alliance. But the ego says, well, you can't make that your only problem. There's other problems too, like how do we make this world a better place? How do we make this a showcase? You know, that's a big problem. Let's work on that. No, that's an alliance with the ego. I'm saying the only problem I have is a continuity problem. I have no other problem whatsoever. I don't have the problem of trying to make of making this world a better place. I don't have that problem. I only have the continuity problem. And the ego says, well, you're selfish. You're not making an alliance with the ego. You know, we can make this world. No. I realize that's totally bogus. And I'm not afraid to see that, because I realize that I only have a continuity problem. The Holy Spirit's got that covered entirely. Why? Because God wants the Holy Spirit to cover it. Because God knows that's the only problem they really have. I've seen that. I have had moments with the Prime Creator, in the presence of the Prime Creator, and I realize there's absolutely nothing to fear. The Prime Creator isn't the slightest bit threatened by us, or angry at us, or afraid, or anything like that. And so I just said, whoa, what's going on there? There's something, you know, something crazy going on here with us here in this world. It's what are you doing? Why are we, you know, why do we need to make this world better? What, is God's not angry? God's not disappointed? What are we trying to impress God for? Something's not right. So definitely something's not right. But we will not realize what's not right until we feel comfortable that, yes, I have a continuity problem. Thank God I have a continuity problem. God's not trying to take our continuity problem away from us, okay? Not at all. In fact, God gave us the Holy Spirit to hold the continuity problem in place for us, actually. So we can't lose it. We cannot lose it. Holy Spirit has it for us. It says, look, this is like a picture of reality. This is like a vision of reality. Will remind you of reality. Take this, you know, take this. You don't have to be plunged back into knowing reality. God knows that you're frightened of that. God is totally considerate. God knows we're frightened of that, but that's the only legitimate fear we have. The rest of the stuff is all based on our pride, trying to convince God that we're greater than God. And God is everywhereness. There is nowhere where there's something greater than everywhere, more than everywhereness, or more everywhereness than everywhereness. So again, I say it all boils down to the continuity problem. The way that I teach this is the way that I teach. This is what I've seen as being extremely effective. Now, I know that the A Course in Miracles and the way Jesus is teaching seems to be a little different. It has to do with relationships, and Jesus says that way is very effective too. Well, I can't challenge that. I don't see the effectiveness of it, but I take his word for it that is another extremely effective way. But I do see the extreme effectiveness of this way that I'm taking, and I certainly got it from A Course in Miracles. There's no question about it. But it's just maybe there's sort of a And Jesus said there's many, 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 many curriculums, universal curriculums, effective ones. This, he says, course meant was just one particular for some people. And I found that the course community that those are using it, I don't relate to them at all. I don't really relate to it at all. I don't get that way. Yes, which is okay. It's okay. They seem to be happy in the way that they're doing it, which is fine. But I'm not going to make an alliance with them. There's no need for an alliance. If some way is extremely effective, it's extremely effective. There's no reason for any alliance. It's the ego that's always trying to make alliances. We don't have to blend all the paths into one, the different paths, not at all. Because again, this moment as it is totally optimal, as it is. When we work on trying to make alliances, we're overlooking the fundamental truth teaching of the Uber teaching, which is this moment as it is totally optimal. That is the ultimate realization. We're overlooking the goal when we're trying frantically to form alliances. There's no reason to form alliances. Let different traditions be different traditions. There's nothing's being threatened by that. Let different pathways be different pathways. It's like there's different pathways up a mountaintop, and they all reach the same mountaintop. And the ego says, you know what? We need to spend our time like blending all these roads together. It is like too many roads. Let's just get one road up the mountaintop. Ah. So when the ego is trying to form alliances, what is it really trying to do? It's trying to say, oh, there's only one way. And that the ego says, well, it's easier to seduce this only one path than it is to seduce all these different paths. That is what's happening. Yes, truly what is happening. That is why the great teachers, they don't try to form any alliances. The Sri Sri Narayana never even went to see Ramana Maharshi. Why? There's no reason to form an alliance or blend paths or anything. In fact, she supported many, many different paths. She says, many paths to God. They support all of them. No need to blend them. It's the ego that's trying to blend. It's the ego that's trying to integrate. That's the ego. Because the ego's goal is to say, let's just get one teacher, one way, and then we'll work on seducing that and forming an alliance with that into this new creation to impress God. The ego says it's easier. The ego struggles with all these different teachers. It says, wow, we need to blend them all together. So oftentimes teachers don't even meet in this world. Different paths, different pathways, except they don't even meet. There's no need to, because the ego wants them to meet. It's really true. It's the ego that wants them to meet. The ego says, we got to get these two together and blend them, because we got to work on this great synthesis. This great synthesis of all the different teachings and teachers, and blend them all into one teaching and one teacher, so that we can then more easily get it on our side, form an alliance with it, and form this vast, grand new vision of this new creation that we can show God. Says, God, this is superior. So this is a huge leap forward today. Huge leap forward is getting into the nitty gritty stuff that people avoid. Is getting into a vast area of avoidance. Nobody wants to talk about this stuff. Because they say, well, that's threatening our alliance. We can't say that. We got this alliance going on. We got this great amalgamation going on. We got this great synthesis going on. We got this great world movement, golden age, where we're going to come up with this one teaching and one world religion, and that is going to be so superior. Oh, we're going to get rid of all this sectarianism, blah, 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 blah. Keep in mind, it's the ego that gives rise to sectarian violence. Because the ego is saying we need to synthesize everything. That's what leads to the violence. It's the ego that says this teacher is greater than all the others. We need to get everyone else into this one religion. It's the ego doing that, not the Holy Spirit. It's the ego that's saying all those things, that's misinterpreting the total optimization of every moment as it is. It's our desire to be greater than God that's causing all of that. Not God, not the Holy Spirit at all, not truth. And so the only remedy is to listen, to find a path that works. And this path is to put the continuity problem is at the heart of this path, to accept I have a continuity problem. That is forgiveness. You can't forgive yourself unless you accept that you have a continuity problem from this standpoint. That is the extreme, beautiful, direct, clear way. Otherwise, you will fall into the path of alliances, and that will derail you. It will derail you because you'll think, well, I don't need to finish the path. I need to be blending, helping blend paths. That's what I've seen so many spiritual aspirants. They think there's some grand plan to blend all these paths, and so they give up finishing their own path. If they finish their own path, then they wouldn't be so caught deluded. And then they say, there's no reason to form any alliances. It's ridiculous. Let me just stress, you know, what I see is most helpful, and there'll be differences in styles of those who awaken, of course. But the central truth is there. That every moment as it is totally optimal. The location of any moment, of this moment, makes no difference. This moment as it is totally optimal. This moment as it is, it's completely, perfectly optimal. Perfectly optimal. This is the realization that everyone has to come to, by whatever path, by whatever teacher, by whatever team of physicians is waking you from your coma. And I know people say, well, I want to have the best team waking me from my coma. It's not that difficult to awaken from the coma. It's just mood of repentance. I have a continuity problem. It's very simple. It's very simple. It just, and actually the Holy Spirit is in charge of the whole thing. So, grace of God, rather. Let's just say the grace of God is what is awakening us from the coma. Everybody will be awakened. Don't worry about it. That's a trick. Of like, well, I need the best teachers or something. No, you just need perfect teachers. You just need perfect teachers. What do you mean the best? What is that? Is there something greater than perfect optimization of every moment? See, that's our delusion again. You just need perfect teachers to awaken you. That's all. There's many perfect teachers. You just need a team of perfect teachers, which you have. We all have that. So the whole thing about I need the best is the ego saying alliance, the idea of somehow there's only one best teacher, see, and easier to seduce and pull, easier to strengthen the delusional belief system of the coma, of that we can seduce this one teacher, help them, give us the secrets of how to make this world optimal, how to make this world optimal, to show God we have some superior optimization. Greater creation. So, all we need is a team of perfect teachers. And from what I've experienced, sometimes one perfect teacher helps me out, and then another time another one does. So they each have sort of different roles. I've gone from Jesus, Ananda Mayamar, Ramana Maharshi, Longchenpa. Those are all perfect teachers, actually. Some traditions, like the Sufi tradition, you go from one teacher to another teacher, another teacher, another teacher. Very, very good idea there, actually. So you don't get, that breaks the fixation on there's like this one, I'm looking for the one superior teacher, you know, so I can then seduce them into help give me the secret how to make this world a better place and impress God, and so we're the prime creators. Now, this teacher, okay, now you go to this one, and then you go to this one, and you go to this one, and gradually the delusion lessens and lessens and lessens, you see. That's very complimentary situation, actually. Meanwhile, we're all desperately saying, well, I need to find the best teacher, the greatest one. I don't forget about the rest. I just want just one, the greatest, the ultimate. Giving us the secret, quote-unquote secret, of how do we impress God. See, they think, well, they're close to God, so they know God. So we can find out from them, how do we impress God? That's what we really want. How do we impress God? How can we make this world so it really impresses God? Right? That is what we're after. And so we think that those who have awakened, the greatest teacher, we think, well, they're closest to God. So I'll tell you this, there is no such thing as closer to God. God is the everywhereness, the smoothed out vastness. Location doesn't matter. Every moment is optimally close to God. Every location, as it is optimally close to God. There is no such thing as closer to God. So, but we think that there's closer to God, you see? So we want to find a teacher we think is closer to God, who's the closest to God, as if God is some location, and as if everywhereness is crystallized somewhere. And then we get the secret from them, because then we can ask them, well, what's God really like? What's God really like? Can you tell us what God is really like? And so we know, we just want to know, oh, that's what God, okay. So this is how we go to work now, and we can impress God. And so once we get that secret, what's God really like? Okay, let's go to work now. Let's go to work. Yeah, we don't need you anymore. Now we know, teacher. Yeah, now we know. Okay, you're a distraction now. Get out of here. You're a distraction to us now. So, now we know that what impresses God. So now we can work on making this world impress God. So God will be saying, oh my gosh, you did something better. Oh my gosh, I'm not as great as I thought I am. You're greater. You're greater. Oh, I worship you. You're the real prime creator. That's what we're trying to do. That's what we're trying to do. And of course, people are freaking out. They hear this. They say, oh my gosh, I got a continuity problem. Of course, continuity problem is the only problem that I have. And I'm totally overjoyed that I have this continuity problem. I love my continuity problem. I love my continuity problem. I'm in love with my continuity problem. I have this great romance with my continuity problem. That's the great romance. So, saying this other stuff is no problem. It's no problem. So you don't need to freak out. You can have a romance with your continuity problem too. With the continuity problem. It's a great romance. It's a universal romance. I have this great, vast continuity problem. So, I can see this smoothed out vastness. Because I've accepted I have this vast continuity problem. It fits, you see? It fits. So I have this vast continuity problem. Which is true, I do. That's the truth. You're agreeing with God, getting on the same page. You're not trying to trick God anymore, see? When you say, God, I have this vast continuity problem, you're not trying to trick God or impress God. God says, well done, that is true. You do. You finally are honest. You said, you're not trying to impress me anymore. You're repenting, you see? Because you're admitting to God you got this vast problem. See, we're not admitting we have a vast problem. We say, no, our only problem is we can't impress God yet. We're almost there, though. We got this technology to impress God, finally. Everybody's got tablets now, and smartphones, and we're really impressive. That's very, we're impressing ourselves, you know. So we're impressing ourselves. We must be impressing God, right? So we think we're real close to impressing God. But what really impresses God is we admit that God, I have a vast continuity problem. God says, that's great. Finally, yeah, that's impressive. That you've seen through this delusion, been able to see through this delusion. Yeah, I have a vast continuity problem. God says, well, the remedy needs to be vast too then, huh? Well, here's this vision of smoothed out vastness for you. And he said, wow, I love this. This is great. I love this. Wow, this is great. This is the movie I've been waiting to watch. The smoothed out vastness of total sacredness of everything, total blessing. I see everything is totally blessed. Wow, what a great movie this is. That's impressive. That's what's really impressive. Meanwhile, everyone in the world is trying to impress themselves. Say, hey, I just sent a tweet to my buddy over there, and they sent back and said, oh my God, Lowell, you know. Wow, this is incredibly impressive. This world is super impressive. But they're not admitting they have a vast continuity problem. They're saying, no, we only have a little problem. We're almost there. Almost got everybody hooked up. We're just about there. Well, meanwhile, I'm saying, No, I have this totally vast, extremely severe continuity problem, but I love this problem. And that's the only problem I have. I have a vast problem. See, all these people are peddling to us that we have a tiny problem. Just this gadget is almost coming. We almost got this gadget. It's in the pipeline. It's in the pipeline. And, you know, it's going to be solved real soon. And we just have a little problem. Just hang in there. We almost got it done. I reject all of that. I say, no. I only have the continuity problem. I have this vast, intense, huge, immeasurable, vast continuity problem. But that's the only problem I have. I refuse any other problem whatsoever. Not even a tiny one. I refuse all tiny problems. Of course, the ego is saying it's tiny. But what it really is a denial of the continuity problem. So I have this vast problem, but I also have a vast solution. God's given this vast solution to this vast problem. Denial of vastness, right, is a vast problem, is it not? And we're insisting that no, there's just this little world and just this little thing. This is where it's at. There is no vastness. Isn't that not a vast problem? Denial of vastness is a vast problem. There's no way around that. See? There is no way around that. You cannot make the denial of vastness a tiny problem. It's a vast problem. So the solution has to be vast too, but it can be a vision of vastness instead of a knowing of it. So it's an intermediate step. I had a brief glimpse of that a couple days ago. I saw this world, and suddenly I realized total the blessedness of this world, but also it extended to the whole, to the cosmos. You know, I said, there's more than just this world. I was aware just a sort of a vastness beyond this world. Now this is just a taste of what the movie that we'll watch. We'll start out with the blessing of this world. It'll extend, and gradually the movie becomes more and more vast. The blessing more and more vast, okay? Piece of cake, if we embrace, say, yeah, I love my continuity problem, so I'm going to love this movie. I really am going to love this movie. I know I'm going to love this movie. This is the movie I really want to watch. The world has, you know, millions of movies that says, you need to watch this. Say, no. I only have a continuity problem. These movies are dealing with something I don't have that problem. But I do have a vast problem. I don't have a tiny problem of human drama and stuff. No, I have a vast problem. Therefore, I'm going to watch this vast movie. This movie of vastness is going to be a great movie. All right. Very great. Here comes the great movie.